the successful design of a multimedia activity. It really does depend on how well you guide the cognitive processing of your learners. It's up to you to help them build appropriate knowledge in their memories, and you should be designing your activities so they're consistent with how people learn. Richard Mayer's research behind the science of e-learning and Stephen Sodden's research on the cognitive approach to instructional design both provide solid guidelines to help us create effective multimedia components that support meaningful learning. How do we use words and pictures to produce meaningful learning? Well, in this lecture, we'll look at the effects and principles that support learning retention and the transfer of knowledge. We'll only be able to scratch the surface of the research and its application to designing multimedia activities. But we'll look at these key principles and effects, along with some examples of how they look or can impact multimedia activities. Effective design relies on taking a learner-centered approach. Your learner should be at the center of every design decision you make. Focus on the way they learn and process information. Understand your learner, their behaviors, their history, their learning style. For all of these shape schemas that impact how your learner will learn, how effectively they will learn, and their prior knowledge to construct long-term memory. So how exactly do schemas shape and impact new learning?
Most of the factors that predict whether or not something that is being perceived will also be remembered operate in the first few seconds of learning. One of these factors involves something termed a schema and whether or not the new learning bumps into one. Let me show you an example of a schema by having Dr. Whitehead and myself read a paragraph to you, one actually taken from a famous research paper. Your job is to remember as many facts about the paragraph as you can. Let me tell you in advance that you are going to fail miserably at this task unless I do something first. I can instantly improve your memory score from between 50 to 100% simply by adding 7 little words before you hear Dr. Whitehead and myself. But I'm not going to do that. You will hear the paragraph first, then I will read you the words.
The procedure is actually quite simple. First, you arrange things into different groups. Of course, one pile may be sufficient, depending on how much there is to do.
If you have to go somewhere else due to lack of facilities, that is the next step. Otherwise, you are pretty well set. It is important not to overdo things. That is, it is better to do too few things at once than too many.
In the short run, this might not seem important, but complications can easily arise. A mistake can be expensive as well.
After the procedure is completed, one arranges the materials into different groups again. Then they can be put into their appropriate places.
Eventually, they'll be used once more, and the whole cycle will have to be repeated. However, that is a part of life.
Did you get all that? No? Let us give you now the 7 magic little words. This paragraph is all about washing clothes. What that sentence provides for you is a mental framework, a way of organizing thoughts around some aspect of the world. We call such frameworks schemas, and you have them about people, situations, objects. This means something profound. Prior knowledge can disturbingly shape how you memorize and retain for long-term storage future knowledge. If a schema is triggered near the moment of learning, that learning is more permanent.
Brainos!
Prior knowledge can significantly shape how you memorize and retain information for long-term or future knowledge. If a schema is triggered at the moment of learning, that learning is more permanent. So does that mean in knowing your learner's favorite things, events, lifestyle, those things that shape his mental framework or schema, can you use that schema to make learning more permanent? If you can, then leveraging the schema should happen within the first few moments of learning. The prior knowledge must work together with the working memory. Working memory, that's the brain's method of holding temporary information. Working memory also processes verbal and visual information so it can be stored and integrated with prior knowledge. But are there limits to how much information can be processed by working memory? And how are those limits impacted by cognitive load? Well, one way to look at the limits of working memory is to look at the telephone number. Hopefully you all recognize this still as a telephone. Back in the day, telephone numbers were made up of two or three letter exchanges, often the first letters of a community name, followed by four or five figures. Like this example, PE, meaning 7 and 3, 6-5000, or Pennsylvania 6-5000. This is also the name of the piece of music you just heard, performed by the Glenn Miller Band. In the 1940s, it was perhaps the most well-known telephone number out there. The Hollywood story goes is that while Glenn Miller was dating his future wife, he used a musical phrase as a memorization trick to help keep this phone number in his working memory until he could write it down. The reality is that it was the phone number for the Hotel Pennsylvania in New York. Many of the bands at that time hung out at the hotel's Café Rouge Ballroom. That wasn't really the story that Hollywood wanted to promote in the movie The Glenn Miller Story. But back to the telephone. Now, as the number of telephone users increased and exchanges increased, it became more and more challenging to remember all of these different exchanges. So in the 1960s, all number calling was introduced. So while expanding the number of potential phone listings by making them all numerals, the numbers were also chunked into 3-digit and 4-digit numeric sequences. This allowed for easier processing into working memory, just like the catchy exchange phone number system. The new numbering system also tried to provide that same ease of use. I'm curious, how many of you recall this phone number? Well, if you were listening to music in 1982, you couldn't escape it. It's another phone number made famous by a song. The song is Jenny by Tommy Tutone. In fact, many people at the time didn't even know the song by its name Jenny, but only knew it as that telephone song or 8675309. I tried to call you before. But because of its repetitive and its musical hook, for many people that phone number can be recalled at will and recognized immediately. You need to repeat to remember. That is the key to helping the brain hold information in working memory. This is where learning begins. With the working memory cut off to be about 7 items, you can hold this information in your working memory for about 30 seconds. If you don't repeat it, the information disappears. If you do repeat it within 30 seconds, the brain will hold onto it for up to 2 hours. If repetition does not occur again, the information goes away. And this time, permanently. At this point, I recommend that you take a short break. This way you can process or review the information that we just covered. Part 2 of this lecture series will cover a little bit more about working memory before we actually go into the actual cognitive theories.